thank you for having me. I'm going to give you a small talk on Visual Studio Online. And it's an exciting product from Microsoft, I think. It's a relatively new product or service from Microsoft that will hopefully enable you to do your projects faster or reduce the friction that you might see in development projects. Chances are that you're already using something that Visual Studio Online already offers you. I just hope that you will see that Visual Studio Online will try to make it more of a convenience in the areas where it provides features for you. I'm gonna hopefully show you some cool stuff on this. It's almost 2 years old now, and there's a lot of features coming in, so it's sort of getting kind of broad in its offering. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff to cover, so bear with me if there's too much, but we'll see. Before we start, this is me. I used to work at Microsoft, but I don't anymore. I decided to try something new. So now I work at this place called Momondo. So the good thing is that I no longer have to take the blame for PowerPoint crashing. And I can also speak about Visual Studio Online, what I really feel, but it is really a cool project or a product, I think. Feel free to reach out to me if you want. I'm on Twitter, LinkedIn, and the internet if you want. If you have any questions on Visual Studio Online afterwards or just want to talk or whatever, feel free to reach out. Before I dive in, I just want to give you a little intro to why you might find Visual Studio Online interesting. As developers, and I'm thinking there's different roles in here, but as a developer, this is sometimes how I feel. And I'm pretty sure that people who are managers, testers, and so on feel exactly the same way as a developer here. And my point is that, at least from a developer perspective, we are interested in writing code, we're interested in designing software, but often it's the case that most of our time is really not spent on these sort of things, but rather other things. There's a lot of outside influence that we have to manage in our everyday, and there's a lot of friction in our projects. And it would be nice if we could eliminate some of that friction. And some of that friction arises in the infrastructure that is in every project, or that's hopefully in most projects, like having a good build setup, maybe some automated testing, and so on. And that's where Visual Studio Online will come to help you. So basically what it gives you is the opportunity to reduce some of this friction. And it does that by giving you some good power in the cloud. And basically you will be able to easily provide or provision resources for doing automated builds, automated testing, version control, and so on, without having to manage your own servers. So cut out the administration of the servers and just focus more on the actual projects itself. And I've seen a couple of these in my time. I remember some places where if we needed a build server or something, we would have to go somewhere, request it, fill out the form, and then sometime later it would show up. It's a lot easier, at least in my experience, from when we've been moving our stuff to working with things like Visual Studio Online, is that we don't really need to wait for hardware to be provisioned. We can just, or IT, if they're administrating it, they can provision it a lot faster for us. So that's the idea, or that's what VSO will try to eliminate for you. It's this friction that we have to go through such things to get the infrastructure up and running for development projects. So this is basically what it is. Visual Studio Online think of it as it's services that supports development. It's not directly cobbled to Visual Studio. It shares the same name, and there might be some confusion with that, but really it's just services that you can pick and choose and use in your development project, whether you're using Visual Studio or not. So you can pick and choose any of these or use all of them if you want, and you don't have to use Visual Studio. It's as you It's whatever you choose it to be. So basically, it's version control. You get hosted Git repository or a Team Foundation version control. So if you're used to having a TFS server yourself, this is a good opportunity instead, rather than managing this server. It's project management tools, very much suited for agile development, similar to what you also see in Team Foundation server. And then there's build services and deployment. So you can get, so Visual Studio Online will has a pool of virtual machines that you will be able to make use of for builds and deployment. They will be provisioned for you when you need it, and it will be put back into the pool for others when it's done. And we'll see how that works out. And deployment is similar to that, because that's usually what you run as part of your build process or build process. Load testing, there's also features for load testing. So if you want, if you've got a web app that you want to put some load against, you will, similar to how build works, there's a pool of virtual machines that you can make use of. So you can get like 10 machines to hammer requests away against the application. Finally, application insights, that's sort of being moved away. It used, or it has up until now been part of Visual Studio Online, but it seems that it's being moved away from VSO, but it's and being moved over under Azure instead. So if you go into VSO and access Application Insights, it will tell you go to Azure instead. But it's basically, or it used to be, monitoring of servers, how servers were performing, and analytics on how users are using your application. But yeah, that's being moved away. It's never left preview, actually. But now it's in preview somewhere else, so to say. Just a brief history before I dive in. It used to be, or Visual Studio Online was published, or it got out of preview back in November 2013, alongside Visual Studio 2013 release. And up until then, it had been in preview under the name Team Foundation Service, which was basically an attempt to take the Team Foundation server or some of the core features and bring it up as a service instead. And after they reached a certain level of satisfaction with the state of Visual Studio Online or Team Foundation Service, it was rebranded as VSO. And for a long time, it's been sort of playing catch up with TFS, trying to get up to par on features. But about a year ago, it sort of got to a point where the team decided that it's around the level of features from TFS that we want. And now most new stuff will come into Visual Studio Online first. They run in sprints of, I think it's 3 weeks. So every 3 weeks, you will see a release. And you can always find out what's available or what's coming on this link. And you will see the changelog for whatever happened to the service. So most new stuff will come in here first, and then it might be part of Team Foundation server later in a release. A lot of the things that happened over the last year in VSO has just been put into TFS 2015. So, but many of these features have been in VSO for quite a while now. So a lot of stuff is happening in VSO, and it's happening fast because it's a service, so it's easier for them to push out new features. And with that, let's hop in and check it out. Is it visible here? Can you guys see? Okay, so the thing you need to do to access Visual Studio Online, it's free to use for up to 5 users. So it's fast to get started yourself. You can easily go in and create an account, get started, and you have unlimited amount of projects and repositories that you can create, and they're private. So if you're on stuff like GitHub where you have to pay to get a private repository, in here you can get it for free. So easily you can get it for free, as I said, on visualstudio.com, and you will have an account that's like basically your account name .visualstudio.com, and that's like the access point for all your projects that you can go into. If you're on Azure, you can also access it with that. So This is the Azure management portal. If you're used to, so Azure is like Microsoft Cloud. I hope you're familiar with it, just at least in terms of name. But there's also access to Visual Studio Online in here, where you can access the different accounts that you got. And it's, as I said, you can create as many as you want. And you can also link it to an existing one if you happen to create it on the web page instead. Creating one is kind of fast. You just need to, we'll create a fast one here, CNUG demo. And I'll say that I want my Visual Studio account hosted in West Europe. I'll say create account. And it will only be a couple of minutes, or actually not even, hopefully, that long before it's ready. I got one that's already ready. Actually, let me just open this thing. There we go. So I got one account that I created in advance. I'm going to open. So this is like when you created a account, this is like the first screen that you will ever see. And as I said, you access it here. So you got your account name at visualstudio.com. And that's where you access it every time after. So we'll create like the first project, which could be a web app. And we can choose a process template. We'll choose, it's a Git repository. And then we'll create the first project. The process templates are basically how your backlog and backlog items are named. And it's like the model, how your project project management part is modeled. If you're used to TFS, you can do a lot of customization in this part. You can do your own process templates. But with Visual Studio Online, they decided on three standard ones that you can choose between. But if you're running agile projects, chances are that you will find them good enough for you, and you can do some modifications to it, like the different states that work items can be in and so on. But ultimately, you have got the three different templates to choose from. So once I got a project, this is like the main dashboard or the main screen where you can start to see there's some pretty graphs going on here that will start displaying some stuff once we got the project going. We'll create this hello thing. So this is like the project unit that you will access in VSO. So this can be any type of project. It can be a web application, console application, whatever you need to work on. This is a project. We can invite users. So we got different members that we can invite. And if you got the free, or if you're just using a regular account, you can invite up to 5 to collaborate. And if they have MSDN, they will not count as a user. So you can invite as many as you want, as long as they have MSDN, and otherwise up to 5. If you have in a more company setting, you can connect it to when you're created in, or you can do it afterwards, in the Azure portal. If you're using Active Directory in your company to manage users, like if you log into Windows accounts on your job, that can be synchronized or connected to Azure, and then it can be used alongside Visual Studio Online. So we can actually manage the members who are then Windows accounts. But if you haven't connected it to an Active Directory, it's just you invite Microsoft accounts. So they will need a Microsoft account to be part of your projects. Okay, we'll start off light. I'm going to show the different parts of Visual Studio Online. So now we got a project. I'm going to start up light. So we'll just quickly go over the project management parts, like the features with the backlog, and then we'll try and involve this project that I got going here. So you'll notice up here, we got these different things. So we got code, work, build, and test. And we'll see here. We'll see here that we'll go to work. And it's like basically as you would expect it. So we can say create new solution, create a nice front page. So we got some backlog items that we can start to add. we can put it into a sprint. We'll do that, and then we can go down and work at the sprint level, where I now added some tasks. And you'll notice that you can work at, you got the different common different levels in an agile project. You got features under which you can have backlog items and sprints or features or epics if you want that. So if you're used to like Jira, this is like, it shouldn't be that strange or that unfamiliar to you. We can add some tasks here. So as part of creating the front page, we can say, well, we need some create HTML and CSS. And we can assign it to me. So that's like, it's similar to if you use the Team Foundation server, it's a lot of it is just how you are used to, basically. So this is like the parts that was there from the beginning. This is what they started out by moving up here. So we'll go into, you got the board as well. We can move around and we can work with it directly here, put on some estimates. And that's mostly the backlog item thing. We can also do queries. So we can go in and if we're starting to grow like a big backlog, we can start to do queries and filter out some or create more detailed filters. So I could go into the current sprint, say a new query, I'd say all open work. And we'll choose any work item that does not or is not in the done state. There we go. We'll hit save. We'll hit play. And my results will show up in the bottom. And we can do some nice little chart thing here. See who's got the tasks. And we can put it out on the front page. And we can start getting a little thing going out here for the people who love dashboards to see. I know some people who do, so this is a nice little touch. And you can basically pin a lot of stuff to the front page. So throughout Visual Studio Online, you can go and pin different things to the front page. So you can see if the latest build or a history of the latest builds, if they failed or if they succeeded. So that's visual or visible in here. Let me just see, because I think I got one in here that's a little more interesting. So here's an example of a different one where you can see a little more going on. So you got the burn down chart going once you start actually using the work items and start putting in effort and estimated work, it will start to show how much is left of the active sprint. So that's pretty cool. And this one is actually new. So yeah, that's fairly new. So that's the project management part. Again, it's very similar to how if you're used to TFS or if you're using something else, which you hopefully are, probably are. But it's fast to get started, right? Go in and create an account and you got access to this right away. There's also for those who love that, there's also, you can easily sync it down to Excel, so you can work in Excel. I know a lot of project managers like that. So that's also possible, and that's a good sell for if you want to sell it to project managers. So that's the work part. Let's move on and check out the code. So when I created this project, let's go back to the front page. So when I created this project, I also got a repository, and I chose that it should be a Git repository, or I could also have chosen to be Team Foundation version control. But I chose Git, and as part of the creation process, I've now gotten a repository that's available. So I can go into the code part, and I will see that my repository is ready, and I got the URL to clone it down, which is like basically the Git version of mapping it to a local directory. and I can start pushing up code to this place. So we can actually, we'll open Visual Studio. There's a nice button here. But just to be reminded, it does not require Visual Studio. You got the URL, so you can just use whatever Git tool you want and sync it down and use it. But opening it with Visual Studio will use the Team Explorer that you might be used to have or might be used to work with. It works just the same with VSO. So over here, it's because I pressed launch using Visual Studio, it opened a connection to my account, cnug.visualstudio.com, and a connection to my project, which I just created. So I can choose and clone this repository. So I'm gonna map it to a local directory. There's nothing fancy about that. It's just gonna put it in a folder where I can start putting files. So let's do that. And it was cloned successfully. I'm gonna put in a web application or initial solution. So I'm just gonna create a new ASP.NET web app. And we'll say, and I need to log in. Let's try again. There we go. So we'll create a solution, CNUG web app. We'll create it. It's just gonna be a standard MVC, no authentication. Okay. And it will just create the solution. And actually, let's go into this one. So I got here in, this is where I put it. So all the files in the map repository or the map folder. And I got my solution going here. So if I go to the Solution Explorer, we can see the project that I created. And there's all these nice green pluses because there's something new in the repository. So if we run this, there's nothing magical about this. It's just a standard template for MVC, just to show. So there's nothing fancy about this. Let's do an initial commit with this. So we're gonna say commit. We'll say we'll check that everything is there. It's good. We'll say initial commit. Okay, and because it's Git, I need to push it up to the server. There we go. So let's jump back to my account. And we'll see that I can easily access my source in here. I can see the commits. I can go to the history and see my initial commit. So that's like, there's a nice view of everything that's happened. I got all these green stuff because I all just added my whole solution. But basically we can see what's going on in here. We can also do it from any Git edit or Git application that you want. But there's a nice little access to it in here. And we can also start commenting on stuff if we need to, like review each other. So there's some ways to collaborate around the code in here. But the main idea is basically that you got this repository. It's you can have this. You have this for free. You can create as many as you want, and they're all private. So you have to invite people to join in if you want them to see it. And one thing that's not so necessarily known is that in a single project, this is like my repository that's created automatically. You'll always have at least one repository as part of your project, but you can also go in and choose manage. And you can actually create as many additional projects or repositories in your project as you want. It's it depends on how you want to model it. Usually people, let's say you got a web team, you got a mobile team, usually they will choose different projects, but you can create as many new additional repositories for the same project as you want. I've seen make good use of it where you might have, you know, the actual code in the repository and a lot of visual assets in a different one that the designers would work on. So you sort of had that separate, but they were ultimately working on the same project. So that's sort of a nice thing to have. Yes, so that is the code part. And we can invite users down to the branch level here, and they will actually be able to check out this repository and see nothing but that, actually. So that's a pretty cool feature. Whoops. Let's go back. So let's go back to, I was actually, because the next thing I'm going to talk about is build. And this is actually kind of interesting because this has just changed today. It's completely new. There's a new build system in it. And I just noticed it right before we started this. So this part will be a little bit interesting. Does anyone know this new build thing that's they got going? No?
I've seen a video.
You've seen a video?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So the thing is, how many are used to using the build system that you see in Team Foundation Server, where you have to manage your own? So that's a lot of people. You have to manage your own build controller, you know, build agents, and so on. And it's kind of, it's yeah, it's not so nice. And you, so basically you have to manage your whole rig yourself. If you want the build server, you need the controller, one or more agents to actually do the builds. And the way you instruct this, how it should build your solution, is you build these build definition files, which is behind the scenes a SAML file. But there's some nice, or as polished as it can get, UI in Visual Studio on top of it that allows you to set up, well, when I check some code in, it should build, and so on, and the different steps that should happen as part of the build. So that's the old system, and that's basically what has been the thing in here up until now. So I was actually going to show this, but it seems like it's mostly gone, luckily. So let's see how the old one was supposed to work. Actually, we can also, yeah, so in my project, and this is one of the downsides of the old system, but I'll get to that. So in my project here, this is where I got this thing called builds, which I can access. So in builds, I can access these, or I can create these build definitions, which will instruct, which are these templates for how the build server should handle my build. So we'll say new build definition. And this is like the UI that you will see, which underneath will put out a SAML file for the server to read. So there's something like trigger, when should it trigger? We can do continuous integration, build every time we check in, and so on. Source settings, which branch it should go and pick up the code from and build. And build defaults. So here there is, when you're using Visual Studio Online, you got the hosted build controller. And the hosted build controller is basically where you get the machine provision from Microsoft. So you will not have to manage your own build controller. You will not have to manage build agents necessarily. You can hook up build agents, but you don't have to. What will happen is that the second I activate a build, I will get there's a pool managed by Microsoft, and you will have a machine provisioned from this pool. It will do the steps that you specify later on, like checking out your code, do the build, maybe deploy somewhere. And this machine is wiped clean every time you get it. It has the latest Windows Server version installed, frameworks and so on, and it will take all down all the NuGet packages that you need. And then once it's done, it will be wiped clean and put back into the pool for someone else. But because you can basically do a lot of things on this, because you can attach scripts and run scripts, you know, that's why it's wiped every time it's being used. So the hosted build controller, this is what we got in Visual Studio Online. No need to manage anything yourself. And the process is where we say, well, this is what should happen. First, check out the Git repository, then do a build of my solution, and maybe run some tests, and afterwards, there could be some deployment steps if you wanted to. So as I said, this is the old way of doing things, and that was as polished as it could get with that framework. One interesting thing is, if we go here, and let me just see if I can find the page. So here we can see, so this is the thing that you will get on the machines provisioned by Microsoft. This is what's installed. So right now it has Windows Server 2012 R2. It has actually the release candidate of Visual Studio 2015. It has newest Visual Studio 2013 and so on. And it's got a lot of frameworks installed, but it also has these things. So it also, out of the box, includes some stuff for Java people. So if people on Java project wanted to use it as a builder, you know, it could also be used for that. And there's even Node.js on it as well. So there's a lot of, it was never meant for only .NET projects. But the cool thing is that in the old system, you would have to go into Visual Studio in order to make these build definition files. So that's like, try to convince a lot of the others to do that. So that's why there's a new system now. And let's jump back here. So now I got the code. I got my code published. I want it to be built automatically now. And before, up until a couple of hours ago, this was called build, where you access the old one and then build.preview for the new one. And now it's just build. You can still create young ones, I think. To be honest, I don't know because it just happened. But you can still find the old ones in here. So you will probably, they will show up in here if you create them in Visual Studio. It's my best guess, so to say. But the new ones is much better. I haven't had that many problems with it, and the few problems I had was mostly cosmetic. So it works really good. So let's try and see how that works instead. So I can create a new build definition in here. I couldn't do that with the old one. As I said, I needed Visual Studio, but now we do it in here. And there are some different things that I can choose from here. So I can choose to do choose a template that uses Visual Studio. I can choose a template for some Xamarin stuff. So if we're doing cross-platform development with Xamarin, where we're using C# for iOS and Android, we can actually use that now. And we can even do out-of-the-box Xcode for iOS projects. We'll need our own build server for that, because Microsoft's not hosting yet. I see some disappointed faces there. But that's the cool thing about this new system, which I'll get back to, is that it's lining up to some cool opportunities. Right now, Microsoft can provide Windows machines for you, but it's obvious that this new system is much more flexible and allows them to do some more cool stuff in this area. We can also just do an empty one if we want. So that's some out-of-the-box templates that we can make use of. There's also deployment to Azure Azure out-of-the-box. And I know there's more coming here. So there's actually coming a task out of the box that will trigger a load test. So we could put in a step that after deployment, it would activate load test of your application as part of the build process. So there's coming more in this regard. So let's try and hit OK. So this is where it's not as polished as we can see. So I just have, now I'm in the new one. It says new Visual Studio definition 1. Let's hit edit. then we can start to see some stuff. So here we got the steps in the template that's that we just created. So it's first going to do a build and run the test, publish PDB's files, and make a drop where we can go and download the files afterwards if we want. Let's save this one. We'll call it build or CNUG build. And I'll say queue build. And we can see here we got the hosted queue. And we'll just pick that one where I get one provisioned from Microsoft. Says that I have no agents online. That's interesting. So one of the new things here is actually that we can now see a log or directly from the agents. Usually, this is the one that I've been having some issues with when I've been using it. But before this, you would mostly just get a summary of what was going on. But now we got a direct feed from the machine, so we can see what is actually putting out to the console once it's running. If this one is going to run, we'll see about that. Well, there we go. So now we get a nice live feed. And it makes it more easy to debug your build process rather than before, because now we get full access to the logs as it runs, but also afterwards. And that's that works pretty well, I think. But that's, as I said, it's in preview right now, and that's what I had some issues with, is this part where it's just not putting anything out in the stream here, but the build is actually happening. So that the actual build is okay. It's just this cosmetic thing, but it's a nice feature that we can now see stuff here. So we can see that it's building my solution. It installed all the NuGet packages, and I didn't even have to. I haven't had to put up any machine myself. I just, you know, I'd been talking for like 45 minutes maybe, but you could do this in a couple of minutes actually. Just create an account, publish some code, and you get your build service running. So it's pretty easy to get started with.
The test part.
Yeah.
Is that only MS test?
It uses MS Build or Visual Studio Test Runner, but there's, if you're using XUnit or NUnit, you can use that as well, because they have adapters that will allow them to be run by the Visual Studio Test Runner. I'll show with XUnit how that works out. Because I've seen online that there's a lot of people having issues with getting this to work with VSO. So I'll show that. But this one's going. It's publishing my artifact, as it's called. But let's go back to my build definition and say edit. So let's check out what's actually available to us here. So we can, in this step, we can choose the solution. So it's just going to find any solution file. We can put in arguments for MS Build. We can choose platform. We got access to some system variables. We can also define some ourselves. We can, down here, I think we can choose Visual Studio version. We can actually choose 2015, 2013, and 2012. So you got some stuff to work with here. Let's go to repository. So here I can choose where it should download files from. By default, it's of course put to my Git repository. We can choose a specific branch, but you can also hook it up to others. So you can choose, like, there's GitHub. So we can, if you're using GitHub, it will hook into that to GitHub service hooks, which basically is a service from GitHub that will notify outsiders when something happens, like if there's someone committing or pushing new code to a repository. And Visual Studio Online will take that notification and trigger a build from that part. Or we can use external Git's repositories as well. So that's pretty cool. We can define system variables, mostly if you're doing your own scripting. Triggers, we can say when it should run, every time we check in, or scheduled if we want a daily. And in here, we can choose hosted, or we can choose other agents. And that would be if we would set up an Apple machine for iOS, for instance. And what we can do is, so there's a, the new system is basically that we have a queue, and you can have different queues, and that allows a security model to take place. But basically, we can add some agents to a queue, and there's no, let's say we had an iOS project, there's no reason that we would assign it to a queue, and then there's only Windows machines in it. So it will not try and start to build on those agents unless they meet demands, so to say. So we can type down here a list of demands that the specific build would need. And if the machine or the agent in the corresponding queue can sort of satisfy those demands, it will be used for the build. So here, if we had an iOS project, we might type Xcode or something like this. But here's the nice part. Actually, let's change something. We're going to change to schedule. So we're going to say every day. We'll say OK. And we got a nice history going here. So now we can see a diff of what's going on. So I can see that this is what I added between the last two. And we can see that it's no longer SAML. It's basically a JSON file that represents the build behind the scenes. So that's pretty cool. My guess is that in time, these will also be available to sort of upload or something, and not just managed through the portal. But that's pretty cool. And we got some highlighting, if you can see that. They made some areas that you can see where stuff is going on and where things were changed in the files. So this experience, in my opinion, is a lot better than before. It's a lot more flexible. And as I talked to some of the guys behind it when before I changed jobs, and they were, you know, they were really psyched about it because of the opportunities that that it provides, namely because we can now use you don't need to use Visual Studio to create build definitions, but also that we can hook up other agents. So let's try and see, I'm not going to show that specifically, but what you can see here is, so first of all, these things we can also do, or we will be able to do on, yes?
A small question about the restore NuGet packages.
Yes.
You define the NuGet keys?
I'm not sure you can do that in here. Yeah, you will have to do it that way.
Okay.
Yes, so all of these, each of these steps are basically a task. We can go in and we can move around, we can add a new step. But it's actually a task, so it's a built or agent task. I don't think it's possible now to upload new tasks, but it will be. And they actually publish all of the tasks that are available now. They're working on they're available on GitHub. So we can actually see how Microsoft implemented these existing ones. If we go into the tasks folder, you will see there's the different ones, CMake, and so on. So we can go in and see here how they're implemented, and they can also be used as a reference if you want to do your own tasks in the future to extend the system. On Windows, they're implemented with PowerShell, and on other platforms, they will be implemented with JavaScript, because the agent running on other platforms is Node.js based. So that will be JavaScript implementations. Which leads me to this one. So this is where the agent itself is. So there's two repositories that we can use. So there's VSO agent tasks, the tasks, and there's VSO agent. So this is the cross-platform build agent. And this is for Mac, Linux, and so on. And as I said, it's node-based. So once you run this, it will guide you through command line steps where you hook it up to your VSO account. And once that's done, if we go into our account, it will be available in the account-wide settings. There's this agent pool where they will show up in the end. And here we can download the agent for Windows. So for Windows, it's available in here, but for other platforms, right now it's somewhere else. It's on GitHub. But there is, of course, the hosted one. So this is the one that Microsoft provides, and we can see what's, these are the demands that it can satisfy for builds. So that's pretty cool. So that way we can hook up a Mac computer if we want, or if we should, and it can handle iOS builds, for instance. Let's try and work with this a little more. So I had a question about unit tests. So for instance, I use XUnit. You can also use NUnit. But let's try and do something with that. Let's also just put in some script that will be run as part of the process. The main intention is that you should use scripts, PowerShell, or maybe, you know, old school scripts if you want, command line scripts if you want. You should use that as much as possible and start implementing tasks if you need something a lot more. But in most cases, you should be fine with scripting your way out of it. So let's go back to the solution here. I'm just gonna close this one. I think this is the last time I will see that build template for a long time. So we'll add a new project. We'll say, we'll make a class library for the unit test. We'll say CNUG web app dot tests. We'll put it in this folder. So I've got a new test library here. There we go. Actually, let's, that was not supposed to happen. Let's delete that. Let's delete this. And let's add a new test. Actually, let's add NUnit or XUnit first. So I'll add XUnit as a NuGet package. In order to reuse other, like XUnit or NUnit, so of course you need the framework itself. And usually they will provide, or at least for XUnit and NUnit, they will provide test runners for Visual Studio like this one, which, as I said, will allow it to interact with Visual Studio build. So let's install that one as well. And we'll close this. And we'll say add a new class, and we'll say mytests.cs. And I'll just, that was a little too much. I'll add a simple test. So this one should hopefully succeed. I'm guessing. And let's also put in a script. So we'll say, we'll just say echo hello CNUG. We'll make a small bat script. My script.cmd. There we go. So we'll pop this in to my project. It's gonna put in the root, because that's where we place everything. And so now I got a test, and I got a small script file that I want to be used in my, as part of my build process. So let's commit this. And we'll see that we got everything added. Looks good. And I will push it up to the server. There we go. So let's look at, first of all, let's just take out the code. So I got my new stuff. I see that it's up in the repository. So let's try and go in and work with the build definition just a little bit, because it needs a little bit of work to you work with the tests. And this is where I've seen a lot of people ask online where, how to get these tests going. So if we take the test step, you'll notice that it uses, it's trying to match the test assembly by name. So it'll try to match something called anything with test, any DLL with test in it. We're going to modify that a bit. You don't have to do that. We'll just say test.dll because I named mine test.dll. And because I know, or tests actually, because out of the box, it will also try to unit test the XUnit test runner because that also has test included. So I'm just going to be a little more specific. We'll go down here. I'm going to use 2013 VS test. And then there's this one, which is the path to custom test adapters. That one was a little bit hidden in the old system and actually wasn't there. It's called something else. And it wasn't that easy to work with. But what I need to do here is provide a path in the source, wherever it's being checked out. And I need to provide the path to the XUnit test adapter, which I added as a NuGet package. So that will be placed in the packages folder, if you can follow me. And I cheat a little bit because I prepared this one here. So we'll add this one. So basically what I'm saying here is that go find the test runner in whatever source directory you're using and in the packages folder, because this is where it pulls down the NuGet package to the XUnit test runner. So I'm gonna use that. We'll save. I can say set up testing. So I got this going. Let's put in I added the command or the script. I want to run that. So we'll use, I got a new step. So we got this batch script up here. I'm going to add this. And I want it to be number 2. And I'll provide the path and I can access the directory or the repository directly here. And I got my script.cmd. So I can go in here. And now it will also take the script and run it as part of my process. And as you might have noticed, there was all kinds of things that you can do here. So PowerShell, whatever you want. And that's the preferred way of going out of it. Yep.
Will there always be a sequential workflow, or can you have
As it is right now, I think there's only a sequential one. That's a good question. I think right now there's only a sequential workflow.
How does the build know if the script failed?
I'm not sure how the script will be notified of that as it is right now, actually.
Can it notify if it?
If it writes to the error output, I'm thinking that it will show. Of course, it will show up in the log that we will see. I'm not sure if in this new system that the status of the step will be based on if it's writing to error. That's also a good question to try out. I don't know if in this new system, fortunately, but it is the preferred way of doing things. It's script your way out of it. So we'll save this. But in terms of running things instead of just in sequence, so in the old one, you could only have one active build at a time. Of course, it's not in. You cannot run things in the build in parallel, but you can now run multiple builds, different queues at the same time. So of course, you still, from Microsoft, you can have one of the hosted build ones. But in this system, it seems that they're gearing up to be a lot more flexible. So in time, we might also see that we can get multiple build servers going hosted by Microsoft rather than having to provide our own if we want that to go. Yeah?
Like packets for NPM restore and power and work task runners?
There are some included here. So we got gulp. We got, I think that might be it at this time. We got npm install, and
when you need stuff there, you just do a command line and execute whatever.
Yes, and Node is installed on the servers as well, if you want that. As I said, there is this. You can find it online, but you can see all the things that are on the installed aside from just the standard thing. So you can see there's Node installed. There's also there's Java and so on. So you can always look that up. But other than that, you're free to bundle whatever you want and do it as you wish. Let's try and run this. So I'm going to queue this new build, and I'll cross my fingers that it works. So we'll try OK. Yeah, so while that's running, let's just quickly go over to something else. So I'm going to say, so this is also a little bit new. So if you want to do deployments, it's easy if you want to work with Azure. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with Azure, but that's in the old system. It was like you could go to the Azure portal in your website. If you were hosting an ASP.NET site, you could just say, "Well, deploy from this Visual Studio Online account," and then it would automatically set up a build definition that would deploy to Azure or to that particular Azure site once the build had completed. Of course, only when it was successful. But it was still a little bit hard to work with if you were trying to deploy somewhere else. So what we got in here now is that, actually we can see here. Okay, so we can see in here. So what we got up here in services is that we can add service connections to other places, and that's the way it will be in the final one, how you will hook it up to other places. Right now there's Azure, and there's some generic thing going on where you can add some kind of connection. This is very, very new. But here you will add, like for instance, they added Azure, so you could put in an Azure subscription, and it will show up in your build definitions as a possible place to deploy. I think I have it in here, in this one. I'm just gonna check. So this is a different repository. Services. Yeah, so I hooked it up to an Azure subscription, and I can, in here, if I take my definition, I have, apparently on this one, deploy to Azure. I got Azure website deployment, and I can choose my subscription. So there's going to be an easier way to extend it with other deployment scenarios than before. Right now, it's mostly just Azure that's in here, but the whole infrastructure for it is starting to gear up to be a little more interesting and allow for a lot more flexibility. And it's done. So we'll see up here. So if I check it's kind of funny, it didn't run my tests actually.
I don't know much about X, but don't you need attributes?
Good point. Very good point. There we go. Let's try this one again, because there's actually a nice, cool feature with this. There we go. But we can see down here. So if we can scroll to the different parts of the log file. But I can also say if I say CNUG. So we got down here. It successfully ran my script, and I got everything that it printed out to me in the log. There's also, again, there's some nice, in the right side, if you can see that, so there's a nice highlighting of wherever something happened that might be of interest to you. So the yellow one in this case is because it didn't find any tests to run, because as I got some help with, is that I missed an attribute. But that's a nice thing to bring something to your attention. And that works pretty well. So let's try, I'm just going to try a new build. If not, we'll jump to the other one. Here we go. Queue new build. We can also jump to this one instead. So let me just check. Yeah, so this is a different one. So this is one that I've been working with on a different side. But this is how the test results show up, which it hopefully will in the other one now. But you will see the test results in the overview here. And it's been added so that if we go to the test part, there's also, you can see runs, and you will be able to show off some nice stuff to the people who love dashboards. But everything, all test results will be published in here as well, from all the runs that you're doing.
And maybe you can?
Nope, not at this time. I've been trying this a lot of times, but my guess is it will show up. But we can pin the build. So we can pin, let's go back here. I think we can pin the new ones as well. Yeah, so we can pin the build definition, and we will see on the front page the history of builds. We can also go to the code, and if we want the repository. So I can see whatever changes that happened in my repository. Again, you can do this sort of around the places. You get to know it as you learn the system that something or what things you can pin to the front page.
Question?
Yeah.
You say that it's too hard to deploy somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
I remember that it's hard to deploy from Studio Online to a server running in another different IoT to other company.
No, not really. But you have to go in and set up the if you're using web deploy, for instance, if you're using web application, you will have to go in and set up this manually, like with specified commands and so on. You will just do this manually because you got access to all the arguments for the runner here. So you will do that in the same way as you're used to. It's the same experience, I would say, just with a different interface that you're interacting with. Okay.
Okay.
5-10 minutes? Yeah. So the way it's priced is that you're paying build minutes, right? So the minutes that the build server is running. You have, I believe it's 60 minutes a month for free. And after that, it starts charging. And we're talking like a couple of cents per minute, I think it is. So on your own project, you can have 60 minutes for free a month to work with and play around with.
Don't link it to your MSDN subscription. Credits.
No, you don't. I don't think it's count. No, it doesn't count on that. You can see it on the front page. So if we're accessing our, you can see out here. I don't think the new build system uses it yet because it's preview. So I think you might be able to fool around with it as much as you want. But in here you will see, you can see, and this is the same goes for load testing. It's just, instead of machine minutes, it's user, how many users you're simulating against the target. So that's, you can see it out here. But it seems like the new preview build system is free. So you can fool around with it all you want.
What can you do if the build takes too long time? Can you scale it?
You can't scale it. It depends on your own machine. So if it's your own agent, you will put in some more hardware. But the machines you are provisioned by Microsoft, I believe they're fixed. They're of what's called medium size, I believe they're using. And that's, you got 3.5 gigs of memory and dual core, I think they're using. And they will, I believe it's 60 minutes. By default, it will shut down. So you got it. If it's not done within an hour, I believe it will shut down. I believe you can put it in here. So you can enable a timeout yourself. I'm guessing that it might say, okay, so it can be infinite. I'm not sure the hosted one will allow you to use it infinitely, but of course you're paying for it, so. Yeah. Let's go with the second part. It's not going to be that long as the first one. I got a lot of good questions during the break, and I'll hang around afterwards for a little while if you want more. And I, again, feel free to reach out, Twitter, LinkedIn, wherever you want. And I'll be happy to try and help as much as I can. But there's a lot of new stuff going on here, so I don't necessarily know everything, but if not, I can point you to probably who can help you if you got some issues. So we saw the build part, which is new, and I'm excited to see that as we go along. And hopefully we will see once this has sort of settled and become stable, we will hopefully see it be used in a lot of different ways. Like maybe we will see iOS hosted build servers from Microsoft, if the licensing allows for it. But it's certainly possible now, as it is. So yeah, we can, if we want. So the different things that I'm showing here is like plug and play. So you can pick up the things that you want. Maybe you only want to use the build part, but maybe you don't want to use that, only want to use the source control part of it and the project management part. And you don't want to use the build system in Visual Studio Online. So there's, you can do whatever you want. And there's, it's almost a year old now. They opened up for some integration with Visual Studio Online. I had a question regarding integration with Trello. I think it was because there's this pop-up, purple pop-up thing in the corner that started showing. That's, as I said, that's pretty new. I've never seen that. But there is some ways that we can interact with VSO if we, if any of the out-of-the-box stuff is not good enough, or we want to use it with something else. So first of all, there's an API. Most services have or has an API, and VSO is no exception. It's I think it was released about a year ago. So you can, as you can see, I'm not going to really go into detail with it, but you can interact with all these different parts of Visual Studio Online, where you can you know, make new work items in the backlog or whatever. So you can easily go in and hook into the system. If not, there's also some pretty cool out of the box integrations. So I can go in, if I go into the settings, we will see there's this thing called service hooks. And that allows us to, instead of having to, let's say you want to use a different build server than Visual Studio Online's, and you want to trigger a build whenever code is published to or pushed to the repository. So one way, of course, is to use the API and start and pull the system. Is there a new release, or when was the last commit made to this repository? But it would be much more nice if Visual Studio Online could notify us instead. So that's where service hooks comes into play. And that allows us to subscribe to something, to events that happen in VSO, and it will trigger some action. And there's some out-of-the-box actions or systems that it can integrate with. And we also have like a fallback where it can just notify us on our own web service and just push some details to us, or a payload with whatever happened. So what I got is, I got nothing now, but I got this create my subscription. So we can subscribe to something. Gonna do that. And we'll notice that I got some different services here that I can integrate with. So for instance, there's Jenkins. So we can see that when I got support for these events, so whenever a build is completed, which is kind of funny because that's usually what we use Jenkins for, maybe. But we can say if some code is published, it can do these actions in Jenkins. So we can use Jenkins alongside of using Visual Studio Online for the code repository, if you want. So there's some out-of-the-box stuff going here. Zendesk, if we want. And if not, if none of these is suitable for what we want, or we just want to do something completely different, there's also webhooks where you get all the events, basically, that is supported right now. So whenever one of these things happen, we can get notified on our own web servers, and we just get a payload describing, well, this work item was changed. There was a new commit, and this is the commit ID or something like that. So we can always fall back to this and do whatever we want with it. So we can do, so I got a small example. I'm just going to close all of these things. So I got this page going here. So let's, it will be a second, hopefully. Let's go and let's create a webhook and see how it works. So we can say, we'll say whenever code is pushed, I want to be notified. And I can filter down to repository and branch level, or by any specific member of the team. So we can sort of filter the event down to a much more specific level. We'll do next. And we'll say that, well, this action can be a post. It's going to post on HTTP. And we can put in the URL. And if we want our web servers to be protected, there's some basic authentication going if we want that. So what I got over here is, so I put up this small website. And basically, this one will just, this is a MVC site. Behind the scenes, it's running web API. So it has a couple of endpoints that can take these requests from VSO, and it's just going to put them on the front page with Signal R whenever something comes in. So if we try and put in one of the URLs, so I got this URL for retrieving Git updates. So this is my service endpoint. If I hit test, we can see that it sent at test request, we can see the specific payload that is sent. So this is what it would look like if I got a message that someone had pushed code to the repository. And over here, I can now see that my application took the incoming request and put it on the front page. So that's a way to sort of interact with VSO. So you can always fall back to this one and do whatever you want with it. I had a question regarding Trello. So if you saw that, there's also integration with Trello. So if you're not familiar with it, it's basically like, it's a very popular project management system. So basically you have a board where you can have different lists and then you can put cards on the lists. So you can have like a workflow going if you want. It's very used as well for project management. So we can see here that I can, whenever one of these events go, I can do this. So I can create a card, I can put in the list, or I can create a list itself. So let's try and hook it up to that. We'll say whenever a work item is created, and I can go down and be specific again. If it's a bug, if it's a specific task, I can notify in Trello. We'll say next. I'll say create a card, and I will just need to provided with a user token, so to say. So I'm gonna, it's already logging in on my Trello account, so I'm gonna allow Visual Studio to interact with it. I get this token, gonna pop it in, and it will find a board that I have. There's no list, apparently, so let's try and log into Trello. So I got a board going here. Let's say, demo list. So this is the idea of Trello, right? You have lists on the board, and you can begin to pop in tasks or cards on the list, and you can move these around as you want. So let's try and go back. I might need to go back one time. And it found my list this time. So we'll say test. And it sent something to Trello. So now I got notification that there was a bug added to my backlog, and the diesel's in here, and there's a link so that I can go and visit it in my VSO account if I want. So that's the idea with service hooks. It allows you to sort of interact with VSO with some out-of-the-box configurations like with Trello, but if not, you always got webhooks where you can do whatever you want. So that's pretty cool. One of the final things I want to talk a bit about is testing. I have some questions regarding tests as well, specifically around coded UI tests. And I'm not sure if you're familiar with coded UI tests. So that's basically, you can, of course, you write, you know, UI tests, so automated UI testing, maybe as, or you can start out by recording some actions, like clicking a button on the desktop application. It pops out some C# code, and then you can go and play with that, or you can just do it all in code if you want. That's not directly supported, so code UI tests cannot be used with VSO as it is. We can do, of course, the unit testing, as we saw. You can also do manual testing. So just manual, you know, UI tests, where you get the, you get a test runner with steps to go through, and you notify or note if something was not as expected, and so on. So that's part of VSO. And there's also load testing. That's part of it. So if we go back to, actually, let's go back to our account, because load testing is not project specific. So let's just take that from the scratch. So load testing enables you to hit HTTP endpoints with, or simulate the number of users hitting an HTTP endpoint, or just browsing around on a web page. And we do this similar, or in a similar way as with the build services, where we get not just one machine, but a number of machines usually. Of course, you, depending on how many users you want to simulate, but we, you can get, as a standard user, you can get up to 10 machines to simulate users, and you can get more if you need a lot more, or you need to simulate a lot more. But you can get quite a lot of load testing out of 10 machines. I think I've simulated around 100,000 users on that for some projects. So, but it depends on what you're testing. But the principle is the same as with the build services. So you get machines, they're completely wiped clean, because you can also provide scripts and set them up with like a certificate if you want. And once they're done, they will be wiped and put back into a pool for others to use. One thing they added is we can also do a like quick and dirty one. So on the front page of the account, so down here I can see my the project that I created, but I also got this new one up here called load test. And if I hop into that, I can do the, they're very specific, the simple load test. And I can also do an advanced load test. And the advanced one is basically a video that describes that you should go and use Visual Studio Ultimate. So, yeah. I think we should use the advanced one, because there's a much better chance that that will work. I'm hoping. I don't know why, but basically this one will just kick off a basic test, usually. It will provision one machine that will simulate the amount of users that that you want. So let's try it in here. So if you want to use it as part of Visual Studio, you will need, unfortunately, you will need the ultimate version. And but other than that, it's the complete same experience as if you had your own test rig. So similar to build services, if you did it yourself, you would have a build controller and build agents. If you had load testing, you would have a test controller and test agents to do all the, or generate the load. And this is all eliminated here, but the way you interact and generate or create tests is the same, at least if you're using Visual Studio.
So test, Visual Studio test be supported?
I'm not sure if you can run these with Visual Studio test, actually. I seem to remember it, you require Ultimate, unfortunately. I'm not completely sure on that one, but you might, you have to have Ultimate as it is, or they might have changed it, because in the beginning it was Ultimate that was required. Let's try and do a test project. So we got tests, and we got web performance and load test. So let's do that. We'll just leave the name. So this is the advanced way as it's proposing in the video. And there's this thing called test settings that we can open. And all you have to, so the rest is, as I said, the same tooling as before. If we open this one, the only thing you need to do to run it on Visual Studio Online is to have this one configured. Other than that, you can see you can also do it on your own computer, maybe for debugging, because this is also not for free. You got some free stuff every month, but other than that, it's good to try it out on your computer before you ship it off to VSO. But you can see you can put in some scripts to set up the test machines. So if you need to set up certificates and so on prior to running the test, you can do that or configure that in here. Other than that, it's fairly simple. So we'll do a quick one. So what we got is it has created a web test file, which is basically a user scenario implementation. So it can be a number of steps, like simulating a user going to our site, maybe browsing around. Then we could have another web test that would simulate navigating to our website and creating a user. And then you could implement the different scenarios as web tests. So we'll try and record a small one here. I think that was the name of it, servicehooks.azurewebsites.net. Nope.
Yeah,
there we go. So you'll see that it captures all my requests here, and Bing is doing a lot of autocomplete for me. I'll stop that. We end back in Visual Studio. It's just what it's trying to do is detect like dynamic parameters. So like if you're having, if it's if there's a cookie involved and it's like a session ID or whatever, it's trying to capture that so that it doesn't record that value, but it will actually handle that correctly in the future once it starts simulating users. So that usually takes maybe a couple of seconds. So I'm just going to remove all of this because there's a lot of noise. So I'm just going to make a simple test that navigates to my website here. So that's my very simple scenario. I'm going to put that into a load test. And I can say, we'll just call it that. Say we want 50 users simulated. And if I had more tests, I could sort of specify the distribution here. So if I had a test scenario implementing just navigating around the website, I also had one creating users, one for login, I might say, 80% of the visitors are only just browsing around, 20% are creating users, and so on. But I just have a single test here. So we'll pop that in. And we'll just skip this. And we'll run for 5 minutes. And down here is where you can, so if I got my run settings, I can specify here. So this is a little raw experience, to be honest. But what you can specify is how many agents do you want? So how many machines from Microsoft will you acquire to run this test? And it's very user-friendly, so it's specified in cores. So that means all the machines are dual core. So if you say four cores, you will get two machines. And you can specify up to 20 out of the box. And you can request additional if you want from Microsoft if you need it. But other than that, you can specify a maximum 20. Yes?
Is it the same as the build thing that you pay per minute? Or
so this one is actually a little different. What you call them? So the pricing model is a little different. So what we're doing here is, I have specified 50 users to simulate, and I have a run that's 5 minutes long. So I will for every virtual user minute, I will pay the small number of cents. And in this case, I have 50 users running for 5 minutes, so it's 50 times five. And you will end up with how many user minutes you will be billed. And you have 20,000 virtual user minutes per month for free. And after that, you start paying for it. So there's some room to try it out. But if you start using, so if you're using if you're simulating 200 users and you're running it for 10 minutes, well, then you're quickly spending the 20,000 minutes. But that's how the pricing model is. So it's not actually dependent on how many machines you spend up. So you can always just say, well, I want 10 machines. But it's just going to take longer for it to get started. But you sort of get the feeling of how much you need once you start using it. So you quickly get a feel of how many resources you will need to simulate your amount of users. So I'm just going to leave it at 0 because it should easily handle 50. Gonna hit play. And now I'm starting. So now it's connecting to my account. We'll see if that works. Hopefully it does. And this time it's going to queue my run. So it ships off my test project to Visual Studio Online. And now it's going to run. And we can actually see here, this run will use 250 virtual user minutes. So you will see how much will be subtracted from your account. And with that, I just have, now I got a machine. It's already starting to pump requests against my site. And I will see results coming in soon. If I had to do this manually, I would need a build controller. I would need actually quite a large setup on my own that I would have to manage to accomplish this. But here it's, I mean, there's really not a lot to it. The only downside or the biggest downside is that you cannot test internal stuff. So a lot of companies require, because they will not, they have some web application that is not visible outside their network. That's troublesome with this. That's not easily possible. So that's the one major downside with using this. But other than that, if it's publicly available, you will get started a lot faster in this way. And now I see results coming in. And I'm actually a little curious. I know the team behind this. I worked a lot with them to sort of, you know, help define some of the features. And they're trying to push a lot of things into this. So this part of Visual Studio Online will definitely see some new stuff coming soon. Yes?
Is it possible to connect those agents with the target system, you know, the system you target to collect the...
Yeah, so that was one of the first. So when this came out, it wasn't possible. So what you're specifically trying to ask is that what I get now here are the results as seen by the agents, right? So they observe some system performance, like the response time of the request for the users that they're simulating. But it would be nice to see inside the target system, how is that actually performing in terms of memory, CPU, and so on. And the answer is that initially it wasn't possible, but it's possible now. It's actually, I'm not sure how that will be handled, because that was part of application insights, which enable you to get server monitoring, and you could actually hook it up so you would get it in here in the application. So it is possible. I haven't brought it here, but it is possible to get information from inside the server. If you have a server monitor installed, you can get a feed from there. And I believe that is also coming. So if you're using Azure, and you're using Azure websites, for instance, which is, you don't have access to the machines, you just publish a website to that, I believe you can also, at some point, will be able to get insight or some insight information from that. But yeah, it is possible. Application Insight is like, it's an umbrella for three overall features. So as I said, that was what, it used to be part of Visual Studio Online, but if actually we can just go and see it. If it's still here. So it's very convenient that they're saying try Application Insights. So if I'm gonna, so it's like a separate, you go over to a separate part, and Application Insight is moving to the Azure portal. And they actually removed everything. It used to be accessible here. But it was basically three things. It was endpoint monitoring, so it was monitoring endpoints, so you would get email if something broke down. It was analytics, which was like Google Analytics, and then it was server, like operational performance. But yeah, that's moving, and I'm not really sure how this will end up. but getting insight from inside the system that you're testing was part of this. So while that's running and maybe taking down my site, hope not, it's only 50 users, but that's what I had and brought along. I hope you gain some insight. There's really not, chances are you're already using something that is very similar to this, like Jira for project management or something like that. But you get a lot of stuff bundled up in the same place, and it's quick to get started with. And as I said, it's free to just go in and sign up, try it out. I use it for my private repos because I can just create as many as I want, similar to Bitbucket. Whereas if you use GitHub, well, then it's public. Of course, that's also good to put stuff out there, but sometimes you want something for your own, and that works fine in here. So thank you for showing up, and hope you learned something. And I'm here for questions, and other than that, feel free to connect, and I can help you. Thank you.